So they will introduce the necessary functions and skills to how to conduct the matrix drift. I think we should have provide this course in a very beginning, right? But I don't know why the president arranged the course at this time, then it's near the end of this course. But in the final exam, you have to do anyway. How to do learning again and refresh your memory. So today, this is a tentative content we will discuss from the basic of linear algebra. I won't call it linear algebra, but it's just simply the matrix calculation. It's nothing more deep in linear algebra. And then to the key of our focus here, the differential calculus of multivariate functions. Especially the matrix input form. And for this one, I don't think we will have time to discuss it, but it's quite interesting. And if we have time, we will discuss this topic. The exact differential form and type 2 class integral will give you a sense why you often see that in our course, we sometimes use some theorem or some method from physics. If you learned this before, you will find that the probability has some inner relationship to the energy. And okay, we are not giving any strict proof today. We just provide those results and briefly derive them. So if you haven't learned it before, most probably you won't learn it right now, right? Because linear algebra itself is a two semester courses, and calculus itself is another two semester courses. We couldn't cover all of it in one lecture. Okay. And a crazy thing is, when I was undergraduate, my university still some other historical tradition. They prefer to use those reference books from Soviet Union. Of course, in Chinese translation. I couldn't even pronounce the author's name. Are there any students from Russian? Who knows how to pronounce name? No? I mean it. So I believe that the mathematics should be identical to anywhere else in the world. But I'm worried that if there may be some subtle differences in the wording, in the terminology, or in the concept, right? I don't know if there is. So during this course, if you hear some items, some words that you couldn't recognize what it is, or you feel that it is not the same thing you've learned before, stop me and we'll make it clear. What's the test we use here in US for calculus?
What's the what?
Textbook.
Textbook.
Thomas?
I can't tell you. This is calculus on
it. Some calculus. Okay. Would you like me to use the blackboard or the projector to write a PowerPoint? Projector. We fled from linear algebra, right? Linear algebra. To look it clearly. Or simply call it matrix calculation. Okay. And first, we're going to the definition of matrix. We start from the scalar, right? Scalar is a zero dimensional array. Just some
number 1, 2, 3. 1 by 2 by 3, right?
I emphasize that it's zero dimensional because in programming, neither in NumPy or in TensorFlow or PyTorch, if you print the shape of this variable, it will give you an empty set or empty list. It's a zero dimensional array. So a vector, of course, is a one dimensional array, right? If you write them in this way, or in this way. Anyway, they are one dimensional. And if you print the shape in programming language, it will give you a shape of 3 by nothing. It's a vector. Right? And for scalar, we often represent them by the Greek alphabet, alpha, beta, gamma, lambda, or the lowercase English alphabet A, B, C. And for vector, we use this little symbol on top, or in printing, we will write in the whole form. Right? And matrix, of course, will be a two-dimensional array. Okay, this is a 3 by 3 dimension. So the shape will be 3 and 3. But a vector could also be a n by 1 matrix, right? You know that. So if we write down 1, 2, 3 vector here, we could treat it as a n by 1 matrix. So in algebra, we don't use matrix. We don't use vector. Everything is either scalar or is either a matrix. We need to deal with vector just treat it as a n by 1 matrix or the transpose 1 by n. Okay. So matrix, we use like A, B, C, the uppercase English alphabet to represent. What if we keep increase the dimension? What is three-dimensional array? How do we call it? Tensor. It's tensor. Or 3, 4, 5 and up. We call it tensor. They'll be the same. Just the name issue. But in linear algebra, we only deal with two-dimensional array matrix. Okay. And it's a the main reason is not it could cover everything. The main reason is that it's easy to represent and to write down in some format, convenient format. So in TensorFlow or in NumPy, you can use any order, any dimensional array, right? But you'll find that the gradient of this tensor will be very complicated to derive, and you have to derive using so-called outer differentiation. You couldn't derive it by hand. It's too complicated. So now we have matrix and the basic arithmetic. For a matrix, we have element wise operation, which is the plus subtraction and element wise product. So for A and B of the same shape, which means A should be a n by n matrix and B is also a n by n matrix, the same shape. And we could define the summation and subtraction be C, and the each element of C will be the corresponding element A and B plus or subtract. Very, very easy element wise. And of course, the element wise production in linear algebra, the production, the normal production is not element one. It's geometric production. But here, the element one production has a special name for Amada production. So, which means each element of C will be element of A. Yeah, this element wise. Then we have a scalar production or scalar multiplication. We have a scalar like alpha equal to, for example, 2 and A matrix. Then the scalar production will give you a matrix. This matrix and this element will be the scalar multiplying each element of A. Right? So this alpha A will become 2, 4, 6, and a very key concept in linear algebra is matrix multiplication. In programming language, we call this dot product, but it is not dot product. And in MATLAB, if you simply write this symbol, multiply this little star, it means matrix multiplication. But in all other languages, NumPy, TensorFlow, PyTorch, if you write this, it means this Hamada production. And you need to write dot to represent the matrix multiplication. There's some weird naming convention behind. Matrix multiplication. So for a matrix A and B to conduct a matrix multiplication, their shape must be compatible, which means if A is a M by B matrix, then B has to be a D by M. The number of columns and the number of rows must be the same. And the resulting matrix C, how do we define C? Then I and J element of C will be the dot product of the ith row of A with the jth column of B. Means dot product A I K B K K. So if A equals to 1, 2, 3, 4 and B equals to 3, 4, 7 then C equals A and B, which means the first element will be the first row of A dot product with the first column of B. Right? It is 3 plus 10, 13. And the second element will be the first row of A dot product with the second column of B. It will give you 4 plus 12 and so on and so forth. So to do a matrix multiplication, A and B has to be compatible. So generally speaking, A dot B does not equal to B
3.A, right? You couldn't guarantee that the dimension matches. But if they do match, it is not guaranteed to hold. Okay? So always keep in mind that this thing. In your homework, this like wrongdoing appears like all over your homework. You simply change the order of the matrix. Which will give you a wrong answer. Okay, but some useful property of matrix product. You couldn't switch order, but you could switch the order of calculation. Right? You can first calculate this product and then calculate this product. Or you can first calculate the later two and then with the first one. This is called the associate. And of course, A plus B multiplied with C equals to AC plus BC. This is called what? Distributive. The same for the summation at the left part. But A, B, normally not equal to B, A. Right? This is called commutative. Okay? Keep this in mind. If there is something we need to like take away information about this review, it will be don't change the order every year. Okay, then we define the matrix product and the matrix. Now, we give some commonly used properties of matrix of operation. Transpose. For any matrix, we can do transpose. For matrix n by n, the transpose of A will be another matrix of dimension n by n. And its elements will be flipped. So for a matrix 1, 2, 3, 4, the transpose will be which one? 1, 3, and if it's 6, 6, and what it is, it will be this way. Right. For any dimensional matrix, you can do this transpose. And some property of transpose is the transpose of the product of the matrix will transpose B. By transpose A, we need reverse order. And inverse. To calculate inverse, this matrix has to be a square matrix. And the inverse A multiplied with A will give you back to the identity. Not every matrix is guaranteed to be invertible. Some matrix doesn't have this, it's inverse matrix. It's inverse matrix doesn't exist. And so the property of matrix, likewise for the transpose, if you do the inverse of two product matrix, you need to reverse the order. And of course, if you start transpose A and do it inverse, it equals to you first do the inverse and do the transpose. Okay?
The definition of determinant is quite complicated. The determinant is only defined on U square matrix. And determinant of A, we use this to vertical bar, then it equals to some permutation. So first it is summation, and summation within all the possible permutation of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 up to n. And each summation is a product of every element from each row. And multiply with some sign. The sign is determined by the permutation itself. What does this mean? It means for a matrix to calculate determinant, we need to first pick from every row, you pick one element and multiply them up. And second time, you use another permutation and add them up. And you sum all the possible permutations of this product. So for a 2x2 matrix, how many permutations could it have? Two. So you first pick this one, it will be 1x4, and then this one. You could only choose one element from each row, and they couldn't be the same color. Right? The second one will be 2x3. But the sign of the second term will be a minus. So the term will be minus. Don't try to calculate the determinant manually, it's quite complicated. But for some special matrix like the lower triangle matrix. Upper part of it is all zero, then what's its determinant? Just the product is diagonal. Because only by choosing the diagonal you get non-zero element. You choose any other element of diagonal, if you have the summation to be this product to be zero. And for determinant, there's also some property you could use. Determinant A equals to determinant A transpose. Determinant inverse equals to the determinant of A and inverse. This inverse means the matrix inverse. You first inverse the matrix and calculate the determinant. This means you first calculate the determinant of one matrix, which is a scalar, then divide by, not divide by, one divide by. And determinant of A and B equals to determinant A. So you don't wonder what is the meaning of determinant. One interpretation is that determinant means volumetric expansion rate or ratio of linear transformation A, which means if you have some object, and if you transform by this matrix A, its volume will be either increase or decrease or keep the same. The determinant will represent the expansion. ratio of this linear transformation. So if the determinant of A equal to 1, means this transformation is a rigid transformation, and under this transformation, your volume won't change. And another very important thing is trace is still defined by divided for square matrix, and trace A is often shown by TRA equals to the sum of the diagonal matrix, right? The summation, not the product. And some property of trace is trace A B equals to trace EA. For major product, we don't have the property AB not equals to BA, but for trace, the trace of AB equals to trace of B. And trace A plus B equals to trace A plus. And another very important property for cyclic property, trace A, B, C equals to trace cyclic U. So C at very first, and then you put B at very first. You should have learned this before, right? It's just a reflection, nothing new. And 1.4, in that order, and trace. For a vector A and B, the dot product between A and B, I mean the one-dimensional array A and B, the dot product of A and B will be the summation of the element-wise multiplication. Okay. But we usually use n by 1 matrix to represent vector. So for A and B, the matrix n by 1, then the dot product will be A transpose using matrix multiplication. And what is inner product? Inner product is equipped with some vector space to let you. With inner product, then you can calculate length for the norm of a vector in a generalized linear vector space. And you can calculate the angle between two vectors in the vector space. So in vector space, the inner product of a vector itself will give you the length of the square of the length. And the inner product A and B will give you the cosine angle between A and B. Also, you need to normalize it by A. And if we have matrix A and B, could we define an inner product? Or how do we define it? For a matrix A and B, the inner product between A and B is defined in this way. create a transpose. I believe this is a small question. We'll answer it later, but in 5 minutes. But first, to end this section, let's do some exercise to make sure that you know everything about how to deploy. So do you bring your pen? So two small exercises. One, show that A transpose B equals to A and B are M by 1 vectors. 2. So that for A and B of the same shape, N by N, if we first do the element-wise multiplication and then sum up all the elements of this resulting matrix, it is equal to transpose. I will be 5 minutes to use this. You don't need to use anything fancy, just follow the original. For the first problem, the agent will be the inner product of the two vectors is the trace of the outer, which is very straightforward. The inner product will be the summation of A and B multiplied together in the n-wise way. And then how do we write down the definition of outer product? The resulting matrix, each element of this matrix will be simplified in this way. So what is the trace of this vector? We sum the diagonal element, which means we sum this one, right? The diagonal matrix. I of n, J is called, of course, equal to putting the product. For this one, first do H and B, and this resulting matrix using the definition of matrix multiplication, the element of A will be this one, right? Each element of A. So what is the trace of the resulting matrix? Likewise, we sum the two summation, right? Taking derivative, we mean this function. Equal to the derivative of
function multiplied by g x. How do you call this thing? What's the terminology you use called dx? Infinitesimal? Which means a very small change of the variable x. What does differential mean? Differential means when your variable x change a little, how much will the original function change? And who affect this change? What is the changing rate? Linear changing rate. The linear changing rate will be the derivative. We will use this differential concept differential a lot in the following section. So if you look familiar with differential law, you could understand it in this way. How much this function will change is a variable. Means we have a function of gx equal to x squared sine x, and we have another function defined instead of g, composite of g squared. Now I want to calculate the derivative of fx, or it's not fx. Then how do we calculate the derivative of this function, this complex function? Or in how do we calculate the differential? We can calculate in this little x. The f will be affected by the change of g, and the g will be affected by the change of x. So if x changes a little bit, then how will g change? Of course, by the derivative of g, right, by dx, right? And if g changes a little bit, how will f change? Of course, by the gradient. And here, if you change the f is so then what is the derivative of fx? For this example, it will be the f dt target needed that propagation, and we derive the propagation for the deep neural network. So it is also used for chain rule, and the idea is the same. Okay. Chain rule?
Yeah, of course, to calculate the derivative, you need some very basic formula. You could look at this table in any calculus.
And for chain rule, there are also some very convenient formulas. Everything up to this point is the so-called prerequisite you should have learned before taking this class. I just do that. Refreshment. Remind you of some concept. Am I comfortable or clear up to this point? Basic linear algebra and single variable.
And here comes the Hooker's multivariate, the key concept in deriving our formation, total range.
How many of you have taken the course of multivariate?
Suppose you have a multivariate scalar function.
What does that mean for multivariate scalar function? Which means its input is a multivariate vector or matrix something. But output should be one layer, a scalar. Right?
For example, we have two inputs, x1 and x2, and output
one single value. For multivariate input, multivariate output function, it will be identical except that every output of this function, we just treat it, each element separately. But output has to be a multivariate. You have a output, multivariate output or multidimensional output. But treat this one as a multivariate single scalar function, and you treat this one as another multivariate single scalar function. You just assemble yourself together. As long as you know how to do the various scalar function derivative, it will be straightforward to do much more.
So, the same idea is if x1 change a little bit, you do like x1
and x2 change a little bit, then what will these functions change? We need to figure out what this what will this function change.
For single variable case, okay.
If a variable changes a little bit, then how much will the function change? Just multiply by its gradient or derivative.
And what is the case in this
variable?
For this simple function, first we fix x2. And we will see that
and this become a what? Univariate function. If it's x2, then the function will only relate to x1, then it can be a univariate function.
So
how do this function change? Of course, it will be gradient of x1. Multiply by what? The Judaism is invariant. And if we fix x1, what will become the same? And then you just take the limit. And that's zero. And then zero on that. What's this? Multiply by a divided by seven. You calculate the partial gradient of x1, x2, to x2, x1. You just fix x2 as a constant and calculate the derivative of x1, as in univariate case. Right. So, the final differential of dn, of course, if x1 change a little bit, it will change this amount, and if x2 change a little bit, this two both change. Then what is the differential of x? What's the differential of x? Of course, you sum them up. Clear? And this is called the why is it total differential? Because this is partial differential, right? And the sum of it is total differential. So for general case, if we have x equal to x1, x2, up to xn, and we have a function of x, then what is the total differential? Simply sum everything. And we now know what is the gradient. We know what is the differential. And what is the gradient for the derivative? Does it look similar to you? It's a dot product of what? One. It is a dot product of this thing. Right. So we call this vector the derivative of f or the gradient. And the total differential of a function is the multi-dimensional infinitesimal value.
So the differential is in a parabola,
is in a of a gradient and the dx.
If we choose x to be what by scalar,
then what is it?
It will be simply this one. So they're compared. And we can do the most difficult one. If my input is a matrix, then what will be the gradient or the differential of this function? So here we define x to be a vector. Actually, we don't need to restrict to a vector. It's just a vector. Is the input just many variables, a set of variables, and matrix we could arrange it in a 2D form, but also like present it in a 1D form, or just keep it for a 3D as a set of variables of each single element of the matrix. So use the formula we write here. The total differential of fx, x is an m, this new be the same. The sum of every m. Then what is the gradient? What's the derivative? Of course, if you recognize this as a summation of two matrix, remember from previously, we know that the summation of a matrix is resulting from a Hartree product equals to one. Chase that T X, right? Which means if you could write down the differential of a matrix function, this way, then the transpose of this matrix will be your what? Gradient. Right? That's why in Minkus' book it lists the table. Because the mechanical form is differential. is x table. Here is y, here is the x. Say y is here, vector, or matrix. And x could also be here, vector, and matrix. And the total difference of dy will be the derivative, like s is here, over. And for x, the input will be a vector. For y, will be a vector. Yes, right? The product is equal to the transpose. And for the matrix, for vector form, for y to be a vector or matrix, it just assembled the result. So, so what does it mean? It means to calculate the gradient of a function, you first calculate the difference of it, and if you find you can use the word incremental massage, you can transform the formula into this three form, and you know that this thing, this thing, and this thing, this thing, it will be a gradient. Right. I'll give three examples here. Line. So y equals to x2, of course, y will be 2x. And what is the gradient of? Then what is the gradient of y? But in this single case, you can directly get it from the derivative formula. X is a vector. Change all the x's, otherwise you get something. But you know that this one is a vector and one product is another vector. Dot product with another vector. This should be a scalar. So the transpose of a scalar is the same. So if you do by this one, what is the gradient? The transpose. Right. So this 2x is your vector. This is the scalar. Y equals to A, T, X, T. A and B are n by 1 vector. Then what is the gradient? Y equals to, remember that this formula, scalar is always a scalar itself. And by the cyclic property, now we can do that. So the gradient of y will be in Homework 1, yeah. I don't know the question, is it 8 or 7? You say the sigmoid function is defined in this way. Sigmoid V equals to 1 plus lambda the sigmoid function. And it asks you to use the Gx equals to minus log Atx. A is also a vector. We need to show that this one is convex. Right. And when in the solution, we use several tricks to first compute the greater derivative and we write it in the form of original function f y minus f, and then do the second step. Someone say we don't know this tree. How should we do? If you don't know the tree, you can just simply use the make derivative, and you will have the same result. Okay. So let's show. To prove it convex, we need to prove the Hessian function is PSD, which is a second order grid. So we start from the first order grid. And how do we take the gradient of a vector function? Differential. We should write it up. Minus 1 plus A.
by the owner, you, we, brilliant, you, brilliant, me, subject, me, you, here we have. Here, the upper part, we have to interpret the four expressions. Ready? First, it's E, multiplied by the number. You need to be very careful about the order. We have checked this question before.
So when we take the second order algorithm, do we need first transpose the directive?
No. start with the differential, and you can transpose it at the end.
Yeah, I mean, at the end, here we already derived the derivative of the gradient, right? And then we need to reformat the second order gradient. Oh, so that's, yeah.
It's
yeah, yeah.
Right, congratulations, you have learned how to do vector derivative, and you are now the basically the only student in the university who know how to do vector derivative.
Thank you.